we would build it at an additional height so as to prevent it overtop, because in other words, we wouldn't want to see that water from the lip of Fuji overtopping us in the filling of Sugar Creek. Any questions on this slide, please? Okay, next slide, please. All right, so what are we doing when we do these flood studies? We look at benefits. We want to see, in terms of benefits, we want to see a reduction in flood damage, which that's a savings in dollars. And what we want to be able to do is show that we have these positive benefits through the alternative that we work up. So in terms of modeling, when we looked at this for the WIF condition, when we put in our alternative 7, we saw reduction in flood elevations in terms of the drop in feet. You see, for the 10-year, we saw the flood levels reduced by 0.1 feet. When we saw the 50-year, we saw 1.7 feet. And when we saw the 100-year, we saw a reduction of 2.8 feet. So what does that mean? Well, that means that there would be less phosphorus impact or less water on those fossils, and also be a reduction in time. In other words, a house that maybe was inundated, a parcel of land is inundated for days, that time may be reduced because you lowered those levels. And that's important because that also reduces damages to that structure. And that's what you're trying to see. You're trying to show that positive benefit. And in terms of duration, in some cases, as we said, we reduce that time from days down to hours. So, and that means the benefit to the homeowner is they can get access to the property, or in some cases where there might have been water in the structure, there may not be now. Maybe water's still on the property, but it's not a bad thing. Any questions on this slide? Okay, next slide, please. So what we wanted to show the slide, and hopefully you'll be able to see it, can give you an idea of the reduction that we're looking at from modeling. This is the 100-year event, and as you can see, what we're showing with the different colors there, those represent the different flood levels out in Sugar Creek, Little Coochie area, and that dashed line is kind of dashed in what we call this project area. So you can kind of see from this slide the different depths resulting from the without conditions, we refer to it, or existing conditions, where you have Fuji causing that backup on Sugar Creek. Now, if you put the slide, please.
I'm sorry?
Go ahead and put slide should have been animated one. You can get back to it and the animation. Okay. The one you were just on.
PDF.
Okay, I'm sorry. We actually had an animation on that slide. So, go to the next slide, please. What this slide shows you is basically the comparison side by side. On the left is the existing condition. On the right is the WIF project condition. And if you look closely, you can see those reductions in flood levels as a result of putting in the levee and the flat base. You're still going to have flooding, but what we've been able to do is to reduce the impacts of that flood. Any questions on this slide?
Yeah, I understand what you're saying, but what would the levees be placed
at? If you go back to that, if we go back a couple of slides, we can show you the location. If you go in case now. Middle. Right there. That kind of gives you an idea of the approximate location of where the levee would be located. Now, again, this is a reconnaissance type of study. You would have to go into a more detailed engineering study where you would do more refinements, more design on that. But that kind of gives you an approximate idea of the location where the levee would be, where the fault would be. Okay.
I did have a question while you had that picture up.
Sure.
With the levee open, will Sugar Creek flow? Will it take longer for Sugar Creek, the flow of water in Sugar Creek, to lower with the levee open because of the actual levee structure blocking, which now has free will to go wherever it wants it?
The answer is that
size to convey water from the current coast.
To prevent flooding on the side, which obviously, to prevent flooding, anything you do is going to just send water somewhere else. But on that, the side of Sugar Creek with the homes on it, could, to prevent even further flooding of the homes and that property, would the Corps of Engineers look at possibly putting berm up in the backyard?
In other words, levees along the banks and that?
Sure.
That would be something that would have to be looked at in a future study to determine whether that would be feasible or not, what effects that would have on the creek itself, and not just effects in that area, but we need to look at what effects that might have too. So you would have to refer that to a future study. This study really was kind of more of a analysis to look at how we just can reduce some of those levels out there and come up with what we thought was the best solution. Any other questions? We'll run the slide. Brian, could you go to the floor, please? All right, so what we have here on this slide, the plan studies, we do a rough order of magnitude cost. What that is a very rough order cost. Give us an idea of what an alternative is going to cost. In this case, we looked at oxide materials as a way of reducing costs in building the levee. Now again, this cost is a very preliminary, very rough cost. And it doesn't include the real estate, what we call operations and maintenance. And it does assume on-site borrow being used to construct the levee. If off-site borrow would be needed, then you would probably see an increase in cost just to bring that material away. But again, in the cost, this is a very rough order of magnitude cost that's used just for planning purposes.
You know, I've heard folks say, they're cheap, but that's not often the case. So did you run the numbers on that assumption? Had to bring, you didn't have a borrow material.
We did run the numbers on that, Larry, if we had to bring it. In fact, we looked at it and trucked in with some resources. We also looked at rail bringing them around, and we saw a significant increase.
I was going to say, probably, well, by the time you had planning, design, permitting, and if you had to bring in material, fill material, that probably almost doubled the cost.
This project, once it's finished, require a cost of supervision?
In terms of maintenance and operation?
Mostly operate.
The flat gates are pulled out by the flow of the water, so it would be more of a maintenance, making sure that they're not finished, that they're working correctly. On the levee itself, it's just one of the things that we see is if vegetation, if trees or something around, you need to remove those. So make sure that you don't have animals or running into the levee, we've seen that can cause problems. So those type of things, making sure that the levees have vegetation, so this ensures stability of the inside slopes.
All right. This cost, rough as it is, whose cost is it? Is this something the federal government would help? Is that why we're trying to bring in the federal government to help with the cost share? Would this be our share? Would this plus more be our share?
Well, to answer your question, Mr. Joseph, this study, we're just providing to the city what it costs to construct this. If the city decided on their own to move forward, again, and this cost is under planning cost. It doesn't include a lot of things that you want, including design, and you would have to really refine it. So, again, planning purposes, this just gives us an idea. Now, if this were, if we were doing a, what we call a CAP study, continuing authority program, then you would have federal dollars in there to help pay for construction. And we would help with the cost.
this levy,
yes,
this type of levy, where I assume they've been built before just like this or similar to this somewhere in the United,
yes,
States. Where would the closest be in? And how's it work?
Well, down in South Florida, we have a lot of these social assistance plans, and they work very well. A lot of some of the other names help us use the same, right? And they also work very well too. And this type of levy system we've used in the past, it's based, and again, we learned a lot, you know, so this is from the past hurricanes. And as we go, as Brian mentioned, we have the research centers that take that information. We look at, you know, what's worked, what hasn't worked with levees designs, especially out in the Midwest, out in Mississippi, from the flood events that occur out there. And we use that to refine these designs. And what we showed here was, you know, a basic rudimentary design. Again, it's going to come down to the conditions out there, what you have in place, materials. There's a lot of work that needs to be done in determining that the design. So it isn't just one size fits all. Now, in terms of an engineering design, you have a lot of factors. You need to do some additional exploration, geotech material that's being used to help determine what's going to be the best design that's going to work for this project. All this is doing is kind of giving you a rudimentary idea.
You know, there's a song about that, or my Chevy to the levy. I'm talking about all the other ones. I think I would call the cost benefit or benefit cost on the others, it was really
right.
Positive cost benefit, and this one really is marketing.
This one, it does have a positive cost benefit, and that's important here, so because we are showing that there is a benefit by doing this project, and that by showing that you can reduce the damage out there. Oh, and reduce what has to be paid out in funds to repair or replace, you've shown a positive benefit to the project. And that's what you're looking for. And on these projects, we want to show, you know, a benefit ratio from our grade to show that we have positive effects of the project, that it's worth doing it, that there is federal interest in doing this project.
I think they've got one last slide, which is important because it talks about this report does at least make us eligible to, you know, have
right.
Federal interest.
So this last slide, in conclusion, in terms of what we've looked at based on the data and information from modeling, from discussions with the city, we felt that Alternative 7 gave you the best chance of reducing those flood levels and deaths out there in the area that's being affected. Now, the thing to understand here is this. This is only, you know, you can see from the size, this is kind of giving you the watershed, the size of this watershed, and this is just a small part of the watershed. And as we said before, this is not a total solution. You're still going to have flooding. This is only part of a larger solution. And that in order to get to that, you need to do the additional studies. That's why we said the watershed study is so important, because it helps us start looking at these things in the larger context, to see how these parts and pieces fit in like a puzzle piece, and to start coming up with solutions that can really help the communities and help them with the problems that they have out there. So, and kind of wrapping up, as we said, the report established the federal interest, which is very important, because now you show that this is positive results in this project. The federal government can contain positive results in joining in and partnering on future studies. And there are programs available under the CORE, or Continuing Authorities Program, as well as that watershed study, to help further that. But you took the first step in under our planning system and working with the CORE and establishing that federal interest. And I can tell you, at the end of the day, I think we all feel that if we can give some relief to those folks who are living out there, if we can reduce some of those flood levels so we don't see the impacts and damages, then we've done a very positive thing. And in my view, we want to keep that momentum going.
But you're basically concluding that this is a regional watershed issue, and there's really nothing the city, inside the city, solely alone can do to prevent these events.
That's correct. Yeah. It's got to be looking at a larger scale.
Right.
The city has done, you know, it's part of the larger problem.
And while in some events it could prevent anyone from getting damaged, I guess the difficulty is that theoretically, if you had a 100-year event and you would have had 5 feet of water in the home, which we did have those events, basically, in that event, you would have 2.2 feet of water in your home rather than 5 feet. You would get an improvement of 2.8 feet less of water.
Exactly. You,
but I'm not minimizing that, because right. I'm recognizing that in many events it can prevent any flooding, but that's the reality of it. Also, you know, make sure people's eyes are open, that it's not a solve all
exactly.
solution.
As I said, this helps alleviate the problem, but it's not a solution.
Right.
But what it does help to reduce damages out there. So
right.
Some of them had 5 feet of water, and where the house may have been totaled, now they have a chance to be able to repair that house and get a little wall again. Because, and also, let's look at not only just levels, but duration too.
Right.
The time that water is in contact, we reduce that as well too. So it may be hours instead of days, and that's important too, because that can affect slowly structure damage to the structure.
Mayor and Council, this is your benefit. Dave and his group are not only kind enough to come tonight and speak to you all, but they're also making a presentation across the street at 6:30 to those residents who have been affected, and we continue to try and be very open and informative with them, and so they actually across the street. I have two more questions. Yeah, we really do appreciate you coming here tonight and doing this.
Well, can I have a question? Yes, sir. Just first of all, thank you. Having been at that first kickoff meeting with both you and your counterpart from Georgia and all the folks from across the state, thank you. My biggest question is, to really know the answers, we've got to do the entire watershed. What kind of timeline would you envision it would take?
In terms of, well, first of all, it's getting the study and very quickly. We have requested in the President's FY16 budget funds to start the reconnaissance. Reconnaissance lasts about a year. In that reconnaissance part of the study, you're basically gathering up information on what data is available out there, what are the problems and opportunities. You have public meetings to talk to people to find out what's going on. And importantly, you're establishing federal interest. In this case, we've already established with this study federal interest, so that was just one step ahead. But the other thing too is to be established the non-federal partners, and that's important. And some of the water, we've been holding some joint under the Silver Deck program, some joint meetings to discuss this watershed federal study. And we can have Florida and Georgia partnering together as non-federal partners. And the nice thing too is also, it doesn't, in terms of the cost, the non-federal sponsors can either contribute funds, or they can do a combination of funds or work in kind, as we did on this project, or they can do all work in kind, which means whatever amount that you would be responsible for the study, you would do in work equivalent to that amount versus actually writing a check. So, and again, as you said, in trying to do these watersheds, four, the big thing here is, before getting an authorization, one way, as I mentioned, we've requested in our FY16 budget the funds to do the reconnaissance. Another way, and I think I've said this at a couple of meetings, is through your congressional. Right now, on the Hill, is a Water Resource Development Act that's being worked and put together. If the congressional members of Congress from Florida, Georgia, will want to push for a watershed study, that could be put into a water bill. And then that would actually authorize the Corps of Engineers to do the study and authorize the entire study. Not just the constant, but also the feasibility part as well, too. And again, I stress, the watershed study, when it's completed, usually goes, we've been looking at probably about 3 to 4 years total to try to complete those studies because of the size and complexity. I can tell you that in this case, one of the biggest things is developing the existing conditions to really understand what's going on. Because you don't have that, as I said, that's the heart of your study. You don't have the existing conditions right to calibrate it and really see what's going on. Whatever solutions you come up with really don't mean anything. But
you have to study upstream and downstream.
Exactly.
Issues downstream, the obstructions, whatever that stories.
And that's the thing. And I can tell you this, from what I've seen of both Florida and Georgia, I've seen a lot of partnership and willingness to work together. And on the foreside, we're working very hard to try to make this a reality. And I can say that I personally myself, I have really appreciated Mr. Hansen and the time and effort he's put in to try to do this, as well as and the Florida side and some of the water management district. Both myself and Mr. Tipple have been trying to work this issue, and we're going to continue to work this issue because we feel very strongly about this. We appreciate it.
Okay, those people across the street are the ones that have the primary problem, and they're going to be expected to hear from you as this along. So we appreciate it very much having you, and we look forward to seeing you again. There'll be some more questions, I'm sure.
Sure, absolutely. If you do have any questions,